We'll be discussing the corporate governance and how to quarantine a director in this situation that we are faced with COVID-19. This session will be conducted by my colleagues, Pratibha Jain, myself, Vyapak Desai, Ashish Kabra, and Mohammad Kamran. Pratibha heads our Delhi office. I head our litigation and dispute resolution practice along with investigations. Ashish is based out of our Singapore office, part of the international litigation and dispute resolution practice. And Kamran is part of our Delhi office, again, a senior member of our litigation and dispute resolution practice. As we know, the world is going to be very different henceforth, right? People would be talking in the context that what is there now post-COVID era and what was there before the COVID era. Similarly, for director liabilities, I would put a watershed moment, at least in the Indian context, with the Satyam saga, which we experienced somewhere in 2009. So the law around director's liability in India prior to Satyam saga and post Satyam saga, particularly after the 2013 Companies Act, are completely different. And there is a lot which has happened since then. So just to give an initial understanding and set the stage, as we all know, right, directors who are on the board of any company are typically classified into two different categories. One is the executive directors, and the second is the non-executive directors. Then, can everyone else put the phone on mute? Thank you. Earlier, there was... earlier, there was always a discussion around what are the liabilities of these two kind of categories of directors. There was some jurisprudence, there was some legal provisions, but there was never a clarity. Fortunately, post-2013 Companies Act, we have now some clarity as to what all it means. Most of the Companies Act provisions, when it refers to officers in default. So as I was saying, the two categories of directors, executive and non-executive directors, now there is some guidance under the new Companies Act. While all the kinds of directors are liable, there is for the first time under the statute, at least under the Companies Act, there is a safe harbor provision put for the non-executive or the independent directors or the nominee directors, as we know, in a colloquial language, where they will be held liable only if any contravention has occurred with their knowledge, consent or connivance, or if they did not act in diligently. So question is, yes, there is a safe harbor provision. Yes, there requires a positive knowledge, consent or connivance to any such non-compliance. But there is a catch-all provision or a negative proof that comes in as part of the provision. That is that the director has to prove that he has acted diligently. So long as he has acted diligently or it is proved that he didn't act diligently, he or she, then the provisions would apply equally for both executive and non-executive directors so far as the contravention is concerned. Now, bear in mind, this kind of safe harbor provisions are first time introduced in the Companies Act. We do not find such provisions under the other statutes where, again, directors are directly or vicariously liable for the acts of the company or the company, if they are found in contravention of such acts, let's say under PEMA, under let's say RERA, or even certain labor and employment laws, or even shops and establishments, and so on and so forth. So you need to bear in mind that while Companies Act gives you some degree of safe harbor, those degrees of safe harbor are not available so far as the other statutes are concerned. Typically, most of those statutes read the same, whereby every officer or any person who is in control or who is controlling the affairs of the company would be liable for all the contraventions that the company has been charged for. With that initial discussion, may I bring in Kamran to give a little bit of perspective, because everything in India these days has become criminal, provisions rather than civil liabilities. And director liability is no different. And that's why it becomes even more difficult from a director role and responsibility perspective as to how he or she should behave as part of their role as a director in the company. In fact, before Kamran, you start, again, for the audience, the Companies Act for the first time in 2013 also lays down and in fact provides for specific provisions like Section 166, where it defines the duties and even gives some instances which are very, very wide enough, which can even include acting in best interest of the company and even protection of environment. So with that, let me get Kamran on, and he can explain as to what are the kinds of criminal liabilities which can come on directors, post which we will straight away jump into the COVID situations and where we are so far as the current situation is concerned. Kamran.
Thank you, Vyapak, and welcome everybody tuned in. Let me just directly jump into how the criminal liability will be fastened on directors. Now, what Vyapak just told us was how the liability of a director will arise out of Companies Act or out of various statutory provisions that are prevailing. But when it comes to criminal law and when it comes to Indian Penal Code, we see a totally different manner in which the law proceeds. And like Vyapak mentioned, that while Companies Act and some statutes do increase liability of directors in case the contravention is made by company, the difficulty with Indian Penal Code is that there is no such provision found in the Indian Penal Code which holds the directors to be responsible or any other person to be responsible for the violations of the company. So how do we actually proceed for criminal actions against the directors? We then, in this case, we will be guided by the Supreme Court judgment of Sunil Mittal Bharti case, where the Supreme Court also very clearly lays down that you cannot call in directors unless the statute itself provides. And where the statute does not so provide, you will have to look at whether the director himself acted and whether there was an intent on his part to act like the way he did so. So two things become very clear from this judgment is that a director can be criminally liable only if he has acted himself coupled with the criminal intent. And that is how liability gets fast. Example of a very recent case of Supreme Court, which was Shiv Kumar Jatia. And in this case, the Supreme Court said that you cannot haul in directors for all the acts that the company has done. But what needs to be looked at is the connection or the remoteness of the act with the director. So how closely was that director connected with the act which is alleged, and whether there was an intent or a criminal intent on part of that director to act like the way he did, which resulted in the alleged violation. So this is, Vyapak, how the criminal side of things will look at when a director is being scrutinized for liability.
Sure. So basically, I think as a director, we just wanted to, you know, set the tone that whatever company faces and company is liable for, it is practically everything can fall on the director unless the director is acting diligently or has taken enough steps to ensure, you know, avoidance of such contraventions. With that, let me bring in Ashish here. And Ashish, this is just the background as to where directors stand so far as Indian law is concerned. Can you give a little update on what is happening with the COVID situation, particularly from the corporate world perspective? What directors should know, what director should be aware of, what are the do's and don'ts, particularly based on those circulars? And if you can take us through the important ones to start with, and then, you know, we can discuss as the debate goes on.
Sure. Thank you, Vyapak, and a very warm welcome to all our participants. With context, keeping the broad structure in mind, which is what are directors to be concerned with at this point in time. And as my colleagues were pointing out earlier, there are various obligations and functions under the company law which apply and pertain to a director. Now, over the course of last few days, obviously various government departments and ministries have been looking into it. And we also had our finance minister give a speech yesterday about a list of relaxations which will come in. And today we have seen a circular come out in line with that particular speech yesterday by our finance minister. So some of those measures which are relevant to the directors are as such. First, under Section 173 of the Companies Act, typically there cannot be a gap of more than 120 days between two board meetings. However, now, keeping in light this current situation, an additional period of 60 days has been provided, at least for any meeting falling within the next two quarters, or where this 120 days is expiring for any such meetings. Second, there was a similar such requirement under the SEBI LODR regulations, which also prescribe this 120-day limit. And in that case, not just for board meetings, but also for audit committee meetings. And SEBI has slightly approached it slightly differently and basically has said that this requirement will not apply for any meetings which are held or proposed to be held between the period of December 1st to June 30th. The next is that under the Companies Act Schedule 4, Para 7 particularly, there's a requirement that the independent directors at least meet once every year without the management and non-independent directors. For the year 2019 and 2020, that has also been relaxed. There's another requirement with regard that the residency, that at least one director in any company, this is under Section 149(3). That any one director in the company should be a resident in India and should any financial year spend at least 182 days. So for the calendar year 2019-2020, this requirement has also been relaxed. And lastly, there was a requirement under law that for particular matters, the board meetings could not be, or at least the meeting should have had the quorum physically present there to consider those matters. And these matters were approval of financial statement, approval of board's report, any approval of amalgamation, merger, takeover, or an acquisition, or in case of an audit committee meeting, the approval of the or consideration and approval of the accounts. So now we have the MCA has come out with a notification relaxing this requirement and even allowing such matters to be taken up and considered through board meetings which are held through video conferencing. So these are some of the measures which have now been sort of announced in the last couple of days by the ministry in context of how board meetings are to be held and what directors, their requirements of how they can approach those board meetings.
Sure. So Ashish, this obviously gives a good perspective as to what government is doing now and what are the kinds of measures that government has already provided for the corporates and directors to consider. But taking this little more wider, right, in terms of corporate governance, which is little more than pure duties and responsibilities, because the situation that we are facing today is not related or not limited to just compliance from a law perspective. So what is your initial take? What should a director today in a COVID situation, which is as uncertain as one can imagine, do or not do to avoid any kind of, you know, liabilities coming on them for the company's action or inaction?
Sure. So, you had earlier spoken about Section 166 of the Companies Act. Just want to draw attention to our participants back again to that section, because that section is unique to India, and where it uses the words or says that the company has to act in the best interest of its employees and communities. So in that sense, our Companies Act does have sort of a fiduciary obligation upon the directors to act in the best interest of the, especially in the current context, in the best interest of the employees and the community as well. Having said that, and as you're saying, from a more broader perspective, that is more from the side of corporate governance, what are these actions that directors should look at in the current circumstances? So I think obviously there are a few aspects, particularly like, and I'll start with one, which is, at least to start with, directors should manage or create a close communication link between the board and the management. Now, in the current circumstances, obviously, there are various issues which are going to crop up. And these issues, it's a very dynamic situation where it's, and you see changes being made each day with new government regulations or fresh limitations in terms of lockdowns or relaxations coming in. So there has to be a continuous communication process between the board and management. So any decision making and wherever there are key decisions which are being affected or can be taken, it is not impacted by the current circumstance and they can do so. So first is establishing this sort of communication pattern between the board and the management. The second and the most important one over here is the safety of employees and community. In this context, government is already asking companies to file affirmation of readiness against COVID-19 form. Though there's no compulsion on companies to file this, and government is encouraging companies to do so. But that form obviously requires companies to affirm that they're complying with the COVID-19 guidelines. And there are certain guidelines which have been issued in how to deal with workplace. So, and which includes various measures about informing your, if you have any employee which needs to travel, you choose that employee correctly. It should not be somebody of old age. You see whether that need is essential. And then you train or inform the employee about the requirements of the precautions that he should take while doing so. Next is obviously one thing which is very important right now is the financing requirements or the liquidity position of the company. Obviously, there are various payments which the company would have to or will be liable to make. They may have also declared dividends, and there could be dividend payouts. There could be interest payments on loan. There may have been buyback requirements or emergency funds which may be required going on in future. So companies should sort of start taking care of what these payout requirements are. And from what I understand, at least, is various financing institutions are all coming out with relaxations and seeing how these measures could be dealt with. So there has to be a continuous link with the management and the banks and lenders to see how to manage this kind of a situation. The next is disclosure requirement for listed companies. Under the SEBI regulation, there is a requirement that anything having material impact on the company's business and financial position, they should disclose that to on the stock exchange. So companies keeping in mind the current situations, some may be particularly hit, such as the hotel industry. So they should, especially in these key type of industries which are affected, consider these disclosure requirements and see what statements need to be made to the stock exchange. The next aspect is technology, because obviously we all are now moving, and as we are doing this current webinar, into a platform where we are basically meeting with each other on a day-to-day basis through these through means of internet and these programs and applications. And we obviously require, basically the situations have changed, and the company needs to start pricing itself of its technological needs in the current situations, how to equip their employees, so that they can continue performing and their business can be continued in that sense. Then sort of moving forward, some of the last few points is something which we don't really want to do, but sort of have a key person succession plan in place. Obviously, nobody wants to say that anything bad or untoward would happen to anyone, but it may be advisable for the companies to think in those terms as well and have such plans in place. You need to obviously communicate what's happening with the external world and the government agencies continuously, because as we are seeing, and we are doing so for some of our employees where we know certain issues which are being faced by them. So a constant communication with the government will obviously improve the government in terms of the steps that they are taking, and would also show your bona fides in future if anything untoward happens. So such kind of constant communication with the regulators, government agencies, and so have to be maintained. And the last thing that I would like to say is keeping probably your lawyers on the speed dial, because there are obviously many issues which are cropping up. For example, obviously a lot of companies are facing issues related to labor law compliances. Can there be layoffs? Can there be unpaid leaves? Can there be annual leaves which could be utilized or so? And obviously there are various advisories coming in. For example, in Delhi, under the Epidemic Disease Prevention Act, which is there, the old British law, the government has come out with a regulation which says that any person who is being asked to or has been basically is at home, they should still be paid their full salaries and so. So while determining all of these plans and actions, companies should start trying to take care of these things and keep it in mind, and obviously have their lawyers handy so that they can get right advice and take steps and avoid liability for sure. And also, other than that, be seen and be acting in the best interest of the community.
Sure. Thanks a lot. Any thoughts, Kamran, from your side in terms of particularly, in compliance of the law as it stands today? What should be the do's and don'ts considering the COVID situation?
Right. So just continuing from what Ashish has told us, I think what's most important at the moment for all directors is to be aware of their circumstances, aware of the sectors they are operating in, aware of all the advisories that are continuously being issued by the government agencies from time to time. And, put things in perspective, it is very important for directors to understand the consequences that they can face if at all the company or they are found to be in violation of those, advisories. So let me just discuss a few provisions which, may get attracted. Is any of the employees are found to have been in violation of those advisories that keep coming out by these government agencies. So first section that can be applied, is the IPC section 188, which talks about disobedience to the order which is promulgated by a public servant. Now this provision in fact provides the power to the state to prosecute a director or any person for that matter in case any disobedience to an order is found. The punishment is 6 months with fine or both. In a COVID situation, we can also see sections like 269 of IPC, which talks about acting negligently, which results in a dissemination of infectious disease. The punishment again is 6 months with fine or both. Again, another important section in the times like these is 271, which is disobedience to the quarantine rule. So again, the section provides. So very importantly, looking at enshrined in Companies Act under 166(2), looking at the dual role where the director has to protect the interest of the company as well as the shareholders, as well as the community. The directors have to, keep in mind that they have to protect their own people as well as also ensure that the community does not get harmed in doing their job.
Sure. The other two aspects which, come to my mind as that maybe directors should also look into the situation. One is their existing financing agreements, because I think the whole financial performance of the company over the next 3 to 6 months will be, you know, very different than, you know, as projected. So one needs to really look at what kind of renegotiations are required so that they do not fall into a default situation. While we expect, you know, banks and RBI and other institutions to also come up with certain relaxations there, but it is better to look at those obligations under the financing agreements beforehand to avoid any kind of default situation, because that can have a cascading effect. Two, I think their long-term contracts needs to be reevaluated, whether it is in form of procurement or it is in form of providing goods or services, because each of them would have a very different impact in terms of you know, provision of those services and cash flow around those contracts. And it is better to be you know, on time bringing out some of the issues that the company is facing because of the lockdowns upfront and without any further delay, because some of those contracts can be saved, or at least the liabilities under the contracts can be saved if you have given a notice of the performances, you know, without any delay, and also inform the other party on an ongoing basis. So I think that is definitely one aspect that director should look at it from a broader strategy perspective for the business continuance, because some of those contracts otherwise can actually bring in a lot of liabilities as we go on. And what is generally considered as a force majeure or otherwise because of this situation may not be such as part of those contracts. Third, if the company is listed, then you need to also look at anybody who is looking at an opportunity to, let's say, do a hostile takeover or something like that, would also have an incentive with the kind of the prices at which the shares are traded now. And therefore, all the strategies to defend such hostile takeovers need to be considered at the director level. The other side of it is that there may be certain security in form of pledge or otherwise, where the security cover is in form of listed securities. And again, you know, that can pose a problem, because obviously you are going to lose out on the 2x, 3x cover by the kind of stock market losses that we have seen and the price drop that we have seen. So those were our initial thoughts. We would want the participants to post their questions on the chat window now. We'll be happy to take them as well while we continue to talk about some of these provisions. I think one point that we want to also discuss, and maybe we can use this forum as a starting point as to what the corporations or the directors would still want the government to respond in this COVID situation. What is still not done? There are a lot of questions and demands from the corporate world. Some of them are addressed, some of them are indicated that it will be taken care of. One of them is the insolvency code, because a lot of defaults are happening and would continue to happen. And there is already an indication that some of the provisions where people could straight away go under the insolvency code may be suspended if the situation continues beyond June 30th, because that another layer of stress which can come in for companies is not warranted in this kind of situation. So I think we have started getting some questions, and let me start with the question which
Pratibha,
yeah, Pratibha, are you there? Can
oh
you? Oh, perfect. So, so this is the real example when technology doesn't work. Pratibha was to lead this session. We just jumped in for her, but she's back on track. So, Pratibha, can you hear us? We do have.
Okay, but I can hear you clearly.
Perfect. So I think,
and this is actually a very good example of disaster management plan, right? So we're living in uncertain times.
So before we So Pratibha, before we take the questions from the chat window, I have one question for you and then we can jump on to the question which has been asked by Sandeep. People are always having a longer wish list than what they have. And government has done possibly a lot, but a lot needs to be done. So what is your take? What is today that you are also liaising with the different regulators and you are taking in a lot of inputs from the corporate world? What is your take? What is still required to be done so far as director liabilities, corporate governance, and actions by the corporate in general is concerned?
Sure, Vyapak. We're actually constantly in touch with the various arms of the government directly, including Ministry of Finance and Ministry of Commerce, but also giving inputs via various committees that we are part of. And I'm sure this was covered earlier, but we also urge every corporate to, you know, either through us or through the various industry bodies that you're a part of, provide your practical inputs in terms of the problems that you might face from a regulatory perspective. Some of the inputs that we've given to the regulators have already been taken into account, specifically with respect to physical board meetings, but there's still a lot of more work that will be required, just given the magnitude. I don't think it's due to lack of effort from the government, but just the magnitude of the problem. I think issues will arise literally as we try and continue to do business remotely for all concerned. For example, even though we can now do a video conferencing for a board meeting, there's not yet clarity on what do we do for a shareholder meeting. So both AGM and EGM will need to be covered. We've provided that input. Similarly, while video conferencing is allowed, today was a very good example. If technology fails you in terms of being able to record, or you're a startup and you know don't necessarily have the means to do video recording and conferencing, a lot of our sophisticated clients also don't have those services necessarily, and you know getting new services right now is also extremely difficult. We've suggested for allowing audio conferencing and then ratifying that once things get normal in a proper board meeting, well, as per the current Companies Act. Similarly, I think execution of documents, as a lot of agreements get renegotiated based on force majeure or the issues companies are facing, there are going to be some practical issues in terms of, you know, stamping, franking, apostolization, and some of these agreements need to be done now, and, you know, you just can't wait to figure out how to take care of those things. So again, you know, we've asked the government to allow for some window for compliance of those issues. Similarly, the independent directors online data bank, it was due the registration on April 30th, which will hopefully have to be extended at least till June. So there is a long list of such issues. We are, like I said, collating all of them. So if you come across any, please do write to us.
So yeah, Pratibha. So we'll take some questions and I'll come back to you as well. But the first question is posed by Sandeep, and it says that mostly you spoke about compliances. What about scenarios arising out commercial transactions, like sale not completed or seller not available to buy, or sick causing loss of revenue, etc.? So I think this is a little different than pure director liability or corporate governance issue. We did cover some of this provision in detail in our force majeure session, which we held on Monday, 3 p.m. We also covered some of these situations later on Monday at 9 p.m. in another session related to tech industry, and then again in relation to mergers, acquisitions, and what to do with those contracts if they are facing trouble because of COVID. But maybe we can quickly respond to Sandeep on that as well on this session. Ashish, you want to just touch upon that very quickly, and then we'll go through the other two questions. Sure. Which I'll come back to Pratibha on.
Sure. So obviously in the sale transaction, the force majeure bit, it's basically looking at your contract to first see if there is a force majeure clause in it or not. If it does not have, then obviously you look at the principles in contract law, which is under Section 56 related to frustration. And if it does have a force majeure clause, you try and see what's the scope and extent of the clause. Typically, you then have to establish your causation as to how you were prevented from performing the contract under that clause, give notice, and subsequently take steps to mitigate. So you undertake that kind of an analysis to see whether there's a force majeure or not. But coming back from the perspective as what do directors need to sort of take care of when looking at such situations. So possibly, as Vyapak was saying, it was not directly linked there. But what they can do is at least have idea on the board of what are the key contracts for the company, and to the extent of those key contracts, what is the impact on the company in terms of the loss of revenue, as you have identified, or otherwise the issues in terms of supply of critical materials for certain products which company manufactures, and so on, and then try and see what steps can be taken, because obviously certain measures then you can't let the management only decide and has to be to come to the board. But obviously you
Sure. So Sandeep, I think you have made a follow-up comment as well, where no contract is done without an FM clause, which may be true for many and may not be true for many others. But so long as there is a force majeure clause under a contract, one, you obviously need to read that clause and the extent of what it includes or excludes specifically, because there are many force majeure clauses that are more limited than a general law. But if there is a force majeure clause, then you fall back on Section 32 of the Contract Act to void that contract in case of such an contingent unforeseen event. While if there is no force majeure clause, then you fall back to Section 56, where any impossibility created, not impracticality. So there is a difference between economic in hardship or impracticality of contract versus situation where there is impossibility, and that is the only way you can renege your contract. In fact, we have written a detailed article, we'll send you separately on that. Coming back to the other questions, one is as per Recordings Act, etc., recording is not allowed, so hope that provisions are not attracted towards the company. I think that is what Pratibha covered a little bit, but maybe Pratibha, you want to just elaborate on that as to what is the provision now so far as board meetings are concerned, particularly if held on a video conference.
So that's correct. This is a special law as far as Companies Act is concerned, and there are specified provisions provided in the Companies Act which will prevail over any general law. So with respect to, currently what has been allowed is video conferencing for board meetings and recording of those. But we've asked for, hopefully we can get further compensation of not having to record.
I think there is another question from NIIF. It says, in case a director is affected by COVID and subsequently leads to non-performance of certain contracts, due to his unavailability, leading to certain claim, can he be covered under the DNO? Will the policy respond to such a situation?
Should you,
Pratibha, or Ashish, you want to cover?
Yeah
unless sure. Pratibha, you want to then come in.
Yeah, so I'll start.
Let Ashish go ahead.
So firstly, non-performance of a contract will not lead to a claim against a director, typically under law. So that is there. However, let's say in the current circumstances, there are non-compliances under certain statutes, or SEBI, or let's say FEMA penalty remains, or there are any other sort of steps which come in. And in that case, there are proceedings which are initiated against a director. Then your typical DNO policy would tend to cover those proceedings and the costs which you are incurring in that context. Obviously, you have to be conscious at that stage, or if you, in the context of DNO policy, if you start foreseeing any situation where a claim can be made against a director, then you need to evaluate your policy closely, because typically policies require you to notify the insurer as soon as possible, even potentially before a claim is actually made or against you formally by any agency or so. So from a DNO perspective, in the current situation, if you are foreseeing any defaults which should take place, I would suggest that you look at the policy and evaluate at which stage you should inform the insurer. And typically then those claims would get covered. One should keep in mind that insurance contracts, unlike others, contracts of where principles of Uberama files applies in its utmost good faith. So you need to act with complete fairness and truth while dealing with your insurer. And in insurance contract would only cover those claims which are specifically put out in that contract. So these two things we have to keep in mind.
Yeah, and also Yeah, go ahead, Pratibha.
Sorry, all I would add is typically where you would a director or officer insurance will get triggered in such scenarios, because we are talking about not being available for a disease, is negligence. So, you know, you could have put a process in place, and that's exactly why we are having this webinar, to say, you know, disaster management is very different from your day-to-day activities. So keep in mind, if a director is not available, let's say you're in key personnel in the company, if you're not available, or and for the management and for the board to consider, if this key person is not available, what is my backup, right? Do I have backups to ensure that all emails can be accessed? I'm getting notices under the contract. Can those get done? Key compliances, which we don't have exemptions for yet, and this key personnel, let's say it's a compliance officer, is responsible. What is my backup plan for that? So both for the board and for that person, as long as they've taken all necessary steps to ensure that they have created a necessary disaster management plan for such a scenario, the liability should not get triggered. And even if it gets triggered, you will get covered for any proceedings that are initiated against you.
Sure. Also, I think there is a side question related to this, that what if director is not available because he's sick or he's quarantined due to COVID? I think that situation is generally covered under the law, irrespective of COVID. That is, you can always appoint an alternate director or an additional director if the case requires. So that would be generally applicable in this kind of situation as well. Only if that director's personal presence is required for some specific contract enforcement, then things would change, which I think Ashish and Pratibha covered in the earlier two topics. So Pratibha,
One thing to add there in your point, and this is just sort of going back to an earlier thing, that it is important that we put in place business continuity plans and key person risk right now before somebody gets affected, which is to address this type of situation as well. That if tomorrow not a director but a key managerial person gets sick, you have a replacement or a plan put in place. Obviously, from a Companies Act perspective, you, as Vyapak was saying earlier, you could appoint additional directors and try and cover the gap for those temporary period.
Sure. So, Pratibha, before you join, we also discussed that not only in the current provisions of law, there are a lot of provisions which straight away put director at a risk for criminal liabilities. While there are safe harbor provisions, but still, practically, things are very different. Now, with the COVID circulars and the kind of measures government is putting, the kind of laws which are getting invoked, straight away creates even direct criminal liabilities so far as the company and directors are concerned if they are found flouting the rules or the measures that government is trying to put. So what is your practical experience? How does all this work? And as a matter of wish list again, how should courts and regulators look at those provisions, particularly the criminal implication going forward?
Sure. We have unfortunately mostly in criminal cases, specifically where, the stakes are high for the government, which is typically the CBI and the ED matters. The FIR, typically we've seen names all the directors, all the current directors, because the argument that the officials in these two institutions take is that since you insist on it being an artificial legal person, the only people we can actually, and criminal law applies to people and not a company, so we need somebody to go after. And so we are going to name all the current directors, despite us having, given them jurisprudence to the current contrary. So in such a scenario, for us right now, prevention is better than cure. And a lot of the kind of issues that might come up that might have already been discussed on the call today can invoke strict liability, for example, on a company, in which case, you go into possibly criminal action. So, for example, you're an e-commerce company and you're exposing, you haven't taken the necessary measures to ensure that there is safety for your employee and public safety, right? You're responsible for both under Section 166 of the Companies Act. So if there is negligence found on part of the company in terms of following the procedures in such a scenario where it is, almost amounting to national disaster, not actually announced yet, but in such a scenario, you want to make sure the best thing to do for you as a director, the 10-step process that we outlined, it's a very small webinar, so we can't detail each point on those, but each of those points in such a scenario become very, very important for you to ensure that you have covered your company from being exposed to any such liability. And that just becomes much more important in a country like India and in a situation like this, which is unprecedented. And if you're in a position of responsibility, then the government, the public will expect you to ensure that you act in accordance with the kind of responsibility that a director at that level would have. In terms of the regulators, of course, we've been, even pre the situation, we've been telling them that, imposing similar liability in such matters on independent directors, non-executive directors as executive directors, even though in laws we differentiated, in Companies Act we differentiated, when proceedings get filed under IPC or FEMA, we see that going out of the window. And so pre this, there was a lot of move on decriminalizing a lot of these provisions. There was a move on ensuring that, there wasn't a broad brush of names included in the FIR. So we will continue to push for that. But in the meantime, as I said, I think prevention here is very, very important.
Sure. Any last views, Ashish or Kamran, you want to add on this? And maybe then we'll let Pratibha conclude with maybe 10 commandments, what directors should do in this situation and, conclude the session.
So just to continue from where Pratibha left off was, as soon as we get a notice, and I think as soon as we get a notice of summons or let's say a show cause notice or an FIR gets registered, I think it's very important for the directors to act quickly and delay, the more we delay, the more it will then lead to an absurd or an adverse opinion being formed by the law enforcement agencies, and the more likely you are to get exposed to difficulties in the process. So the advice from my end would be to act very quickly, immediately, as soon as your notice or summons, just call your lawyer or give us a call for that matter. And over to you, Rep.
Sure. So Pratibha, yeah, your concluding remarks on ultimately with the law, the way it stands, the situation that we are facing, the uncertainty that we are already grappling with, what is your final advice? If there are, 6, 8, 10 things that the director should be concerned of, thinking of the do's and don'ts, and what is your concluding thought on that?
Sure, thanks, Vyapak. I think hopefully Ashish would have covered the 10 commandments that we had drawn. Broadly, what I would say is we are still seeing a lot of board being reactive rather than being proactive. I think there is a need for both a short-term and a long-term plan. And while we are looking at short-term in terms of, ensuring that compliances are happening, ensuring that the compliance officer is taking care of whatever the necessary requirements being fulfilled are, we at management and board level will have to have a certain amount of looking to the future and seeing once you're coming out of this, what is happening, what might happen in terms of the business I am in and in terms of the liabilities and actually the opportunities that might come up. So we are seeing a lot of renegotiating of contracts. We are seeing movement into different industries. We are seeing putting in place a communication plan. We are seeing, our key clients expecting us to be available 24/7 to answer any emergency questions. We are seeing a lot of questions on employee-related issues, specifically on compensation. I think we have a separate session on that, but how you do compensation, going forward, how do you manage your liquidity and financing going forward, keeping emergency funds, not just for your business, but including employee emergencies that might come up. And then last but not the least, the security, cybersecurity concerns. Even before this crisis, we had seen uptick in cybersecurity issues with respect to our clients. As we all go remote in terms of financial transactions and not being able to verify stuff physically, I think that is going to be extremely key to ensure that liabilities are not arising because we were not concerned through that of that risk. I think those are very broad headings. If clients want, what we are doing is we are then going into details of all of those in terms of the legal risks attached to them, right? So, for example, if you're a listed company and you don't have a proper disclosure process thought through for what impacts are happening on your company, for a communication plan for media in case of any disaster related to your company, communicating with the shareholders in terms of any issues arising in the company on a timely basis. I think all of those things, we are going into each and every aspect in details with our clients.
Sure. Thanks, Pratibha. And we are dot at 4 p.m. now, which is the time we would want to conclude this session while we will continue to debate on other platforms.